Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Institute for Fiscal Studies on the UK Autumn Budget Statement and wider UK context, with a view to informing our scrutiny of the upcoming Scottish Budget 2023-24. We're joined remotely by David Phillips, Associate Director, and Ben Zaranko, Senior Research Economist at the Institute for Fiscal Studies. I welcome you both to the meeting, and I will move straight to questions. So, in your submission, we understand that the OBR notes that the economic position in the UK with regard to fiscal policy has been beset in the last 6 months by a series of dramatic swings in the direction of fiscal policy, with five major fiscal statements delivered by three successive governments. And the net impact of this series of announcements and reversals has been to add over £40 billion of borrowing by 2027-2028. Can you advise us to what the impact of this would be, not just on the UK economy, but specifically on Scotland's economy?
Do you want to go first?
Sure. Thank you very much for having us this morning. I guess the key thing that we need to emphasise in all of this is that the UK has undergone an adverse terms of trade shock that makes us poorer as a country. The things that we import have become more expensive, gas and food in particular, and the things that we export have not gone up in price to the same extent, and that makes us a poorer nation. And there have been, you know, various swings in fiscal policy, of course, over the course of this year, some quite dramatic ones. But I think the fundamental thing is that whatever fiscal policy course had been taken, we would have suffered this shock and we would have become poorer. And in looking into the medium term, the two key things that come from the OBR forecast are, one, a deterioration in the outlook for growth, a weak outlook for the economy. They're more optimistic than the bank. They're sort of middle of the pack when it comes to other independent forecasters. And that weak outlook for economic growth is then, the fiscal challenge of that is compounded by a large increase in how much we can expect to spend on debt interest as a consequence of higher inflation and in particular, higher interest rates. And what that combines to do is make the, you know, the government's public finance position worse on aggregate. By a substantial, you know, something like £80 billion by the end of the forecast period. The government has chosen to offset part of that through tax rises and cutting back on its spending plans. But we've also just absorbed some of that, and the government loosened its fiscal rules. It's set to meet them by a hair's breadth. And, you know, things are highly uncertain, but as it stands, we're only just on course to meet those. And for Scotland, what that means is probably several years of squeezed funding as inflation eats away at the real value of the public service budgets that have been set out and the grant funding that's been provided to the Scottish Government, combined with various tax rises as the government freezes essentially every tax threshold in sight in an attempt to try and raise revenue. And I think that will exacerbate challenges facing the Scottish Government, in particular Scottish public services. And I'll stop there. I wonder if David has anything to add.
David?
Yes. No, I think Ben has said it perfectly there. In terms of the impacts on Scotland, I'm sure we'll come to this in a little bit. There was a slight loosening in terms of the spending envelopes for the next 2 years. That will mean a bit more funding for the Scottish Government next year than previously expected. Although in 2024, my back of the envelope calculation suggests that whilst there's more money coming through the Barnett formula than the Scottish Government had sort of built into its medium term plans, actually the fact that the UK government is no longer cutting the basic rate of income tax in the rest of the UK means a higher block grant adjustment that might more than offset that. So from 2024 onwards, actually less funding for the Scottish Government because of the higher block grant adjustment potentially, and then beyond that, the tighter spending envelopes. And of course, you know, the people of Scotland will be affected by this economic downturn, you know, as much as in the rest of the UK, one would imagine. And in the short term, at least, you know, the higher energy costs will probably impact people in Scotland somewhat more, given the sort of colder weather, you know, sort of higher needs for heating, especially during winter. I think on the kind of point you were sort of making around the, you know, to what extent was it the sort of flip-flopping on policy that sort of exacerbated this economic outlook? I think to some extent that is a bit unclear. It was clear earlier on that the UK had seen a bigger rise in interest rates than the other countries during the sort of, you know, aftermath of the mini budget. That now seems to have sort of largely disappeared with sort of the reversal of those and a sort of fiscal tightening. And then the open question is, you know, whether the fiscal tightening had to be a bit more, you know, significant than otherwise would have had to be the case in the absence of that flip-flopping and the potential loss of credibility. Although, as Ben says, actually, a substantial chunk of the extra borrowing planned is just being allowed to go ahead. The UK government is only planning to offset, you know, part, not all of the weakening in the public finance position, which actually might kind of store up, you know, some problems for the longer term with a sort of higher level of debt. And, you know, as it stands, you know, debt will be, you know, very, very fractionally falling in the medium term, as previously they'd sort of set up plans for it to be, you know, falling sooner and falling at a faster rate.
Yeah, I think we can all see that the plan is for the real impact of the budget to fall after the next UK general election. But do you disagree then with the OBR when they say that these continual policy changes have cost some £40 billion in terms of additional borrowing? Because that seems to be the implication of your response here, David.
I'll hand over to Ben in a second, but I wasn't aware the OBR had said that the policy changes had, you know, the actual changes in fiscal policy had led to that £40 billion of weakening in the public finances. Yeah. As Ben said, my understanding was that, you know, whilst there was some element of, potentially some element, and certainly at the time they were doing their forecasts, higher interest costs potentially related to the somewhat reduction in credibility of the UK's fiscal policy. But the main factor underlying it was the deterioration in the underlying economic environment. Ben, I don't know if you want to add anything on that.
My understanding is that comes from, indeed, Richard Hughes, the chair of the OBR. But we'll move on, because you talked about growth. Now, I was looking at the Economist Review of 2023, when, as you'll know, every year it provides a number of forecasts, not the kind of forecasts that we generally discuss, but predictions, perhaps is probably a better word, for economic growth, etc. And what it says is that the United Kingdom, it believes, will grow at -0.8% next year, with a per capita income of $55,000 at purchasing power parity, whereas the Republic of Ireland will grow at 5.4% with a purchasing power parity per capita income of $135,000. Why is the UK in such a different position from countries like Ireland just next door?
So in terms of Ireland, I think there's a particular factor with Ireland's GDP, whereby the activities of multinational companies like Apple and Google and others, airline companies actually, that either base their assets or route their profits via Ireland, lead to an overstatement of Ireland's GDP relative to sort of other countries. So the Irish Statistical Agency has produced another measure called GNI Star, which tries to strip those out. That still shows Ireland being better off than the UK, but it's not sort of, you know, more than two times better off on that measure. I think it's definitely the case that, you know, relative to other Northern and Western European countries, the UK has poor productivity, and that has been, you know, a long-standing problem. We saw some reduction in that gap during the sort of late 80s to the sort of late 2000s, and that gap has widened since the late 2000s. The precise reasons for that gap are sort of somewhat uncertain, but there's a range of factors such as low investment, especially, you know, business investment in fixed capital, relatively poor skills, especially, you know, poor sort of intermediate level skills, and, you know, issues around potentially, you know, property market and sort of supply of property have been raised. So, you know, it's undoubtedly the case that the UK is a bit of a laggard relative to its neighbours in terms of productivity. That's true. In terms of the outlook going forwards, the UK is also one of the economies projected to do least well during, I think, you know, the sort of 22 to sort of 24 period. I think to some extent that will be linked to our reliance on gas as an energy source, where the price increases have been particularly large. But there could be other factors that play as well. For example, the kind of ongoing fallout from Brexit. There could be impacts of, you know, historic low investment. So there could be several factors underlying that. I don't know if Ben wants to add any more.
Okay, Ben, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, if I could quickly. If I could also offer a very brief response to your previous question on the 40 billion number. So I think I've understood you correctly, that's the OBR's estimate of the fiscal tightening the government's done in 2026-27, and that's relative to a deterioration in the forecast of around 80 billion. So they're offsetting about half of it, and the fiscal tightening is going through about 40% tax, 60% spending cuts. But the big question for us, I think, is, that's stated government policy, and that's fine. But there are questions about, one, whether you can really freeze income tax thresholds for that long, or whether pressure will build for that policy to fall apart as well. So will those tax rises actually go ahead? And will the government actually be able to keep a lid on spending to that extent? Will it be able to get away with offering 1% average real terms increases in the face of substantial pressures on public services? So if you think that maybe spending plans will get topped up and some future government will backtrack on some of the planned tax rises, that number could change. And one thing just to add to David's answer about why the UK's growth outlook looks worse than other countries, of course, trade has to be part of this. There is clear signs in the data now that impacts of us leaving the European Union is starting to affect our exports, particularly of services, of things like finance and professional services. That's having a clear impact. And I think there's increasing evidence that the health of the UK population seems to have worsened by more than in other parts of Europe. And I think there's a bit of a puzzle as to why that's the case, but you can see it in, for example, disability claimants data, or you can see it in a number of people dropping out of the labour force to become inactive. There are clear signs that the health of the population seems to have taken a hit, and that is feeding through to our productivity as a country and to our economic fortunes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good point. I mean, I understand that it's a 600,000 increase in the number of people economically inactive relative to before the pandemic. So I do appreciate that's an issue. One of the things that's been predicted is a 7% fall in living standards over the next 2 years. But obviously, the impact of that will vary considerably. And can you advise as to where you feel which groups in society will be most and least impacted? Ben?
Yes, thank you. I was waiting for me to come off mute. So the government support package is broadly a progressive one. There's a clear focus being made to try and target support on lower income households. I think that this winter, given the, you know, the broad sweeping energy price guarantee, households will be insulated from the worst of the shock. I think the big question is what happens after April and the design of that new scheme. I think the two groups you might worry about in particular are those that have very high energy needs. If you've got a large family in a drafty house in a cold bit of the country, for example, or we might worry that if the government provides support, let's say, just to people who are on means-tested benefits, if you either are just on the wrong side of a sharp cutoff day, or perhaps you haven't, you know, applied for benefits for which you're eligible, some people who have high needs might not qualify for very much support at all, and those are the groups that we might be concerned about. And then our general point here is that we know that inflation is higher for poorer households. They spend a much bigger fraction of their budgets on things like food and gas, where inflation is highest. And so even though benefits will be uprated in line with CPI come April, or September CPI just gone, that probably isn't actually keeping pace with the inflation rates faced by poorer households, which will probably exceed the 10% or so average across the economy. So those groups we should be very concerned about in the coming years. But as you say, 7% fall in average living standards is really horrific. This is going to hurt right the way across the income distribution. And that's why it's very important that the government spend time and effort trying to make sure the support systems are well designed and well executed.
Okay, thank you. Now, if the prediction is there'll be a 1%, I mentioned, increase in real incomes by 2027-28, but surely how can you possibly predict that kind of level of growth at this point, given all the potential shocks that we might see? I mean, if someone had predicted that 5 years ago, everyone would have been astonished. Everyone would have expected, of course, 5 years ago, a five-year prediction ahead to be much more positive. So how much of a pinch of salt do we need to treat this with?
Well, these forecasts are subject to enormous uncertainty that really can't be exaggerated enough. For public finance forecasts and economic forecasts are uncertain at the best of times. It's very much an art, not a science. These forecasts are extremely uncertain. Clearly, nobody knows how the next few months are going to pan out, never mind the next few years. But it's possible, of course, that we'll see gas prices fall back. It's possible that we'll see some sort of upside benefits for the public finances, for example. It's possible that interest rates won't rise by anywhere near as much as what the market assumes, which is what underpins the OBR's forecast. That might mean that actually borrowing turns out, let's say, 10, 15 billion better, and that's money that can be reallocated towards other priorities and public services or tax cuts. So there are potential upside benefits and risks. But of course, as you say, there are many potential shocks on the horizon. Things can always turn out worse. And that's what we should have learned, if nothing else, that from the past 12 months. And so I guess the key determinant here is outside of our hands. It's really what happens to global energy prices and when. That's going to be essentially the key determinant of what happens to growth and what happens to household incomes. And we can just plan on the basis of a central scenario, but we have to recognise the uncertainty around it.
Okay, David?
Yeah, okay, I'm muted now. I would echo what Ben said there. There's two further points I would just sort of make. The first is, as Ben says, you know, the OBR has made what it kind of thinks is a central forecast, and its forecast is sort of in the middle of the pack. It's not one of the more optimistic ones. It's not one of the more pessimistic ones. The Bank of England is much more pessimistic than the OBR. And there are two main reasons why it's more pessimistic. It's not to do with oil and gas and other things like that, actually. They both tend to use similar information on that. The main factors are an assumption about how consumers respond to the recession. So the OBR assumes that, unlike in most recessions where people actually cut back their spending, they kind of engage what's called precautionary saving, that because the nature of the recession, where it's sort of, you know, oil and gas prices, you know, things that you can't cut back on so much. But actually, even more importantly, many higher income households in particular still have some pandemic savings they can draw down on. There will be all things that consumer spending will hold up better than it usually does in recessions. And secondly, and the bank doesn't think that will be the case. And secondly, the OBR assumes that productivity growth, whilst not returning to its sort of, you know, pre-2008 levels, will start to pick up a little bit again, whereas the Bank of England, you know, sort of in its projections, assumes that will not be the case. But I think the Bank of England sort of, you know, shows, you know, what might happen if the recession, if people do cut back, if people are scared and cut back their spending, and if productivity doesn't return, the kind of growth forecast you see there would mean a much weaker outlook for the public finances, much bigger cuts. But as Ben says, if, you know, things survive on the upside, you know, whether that's oil or gas, or whether it's other factors like, for example, productivity growth that turns out to actually resume at a faster rate, that could, you know, be an upside thing. The last point I'd make on this is that, you know, relative to where we were previously with the fiscal rules, the previous fiscal rules were more stringent, but Rishi Sunak had planned to meet them with a bigger headroom. So that if there had been a little bit of a surprise on the downside, but that wasn't too big, he wouldn't have to revisit his plans. If Jeremy Hunt is wanted to meet his rules, at the moment, as Ben said, he's meeting with a hair's breadth. So if things turn out even just slightly worse, that would mean either tearing up those rules or engaging in further tax rises or spending cuts.
Okay, so we're basically walking a tightrope. What's how much is the UK spend in the current, the last month for which you've got figures in paying interest on its debt?
I haven't got those figures to hand. I don't know if Ben does. I know in the medium term, the forecast is around £100 billion a year. So that would average about £8 billion a month. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure it is in the most recent month.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's obviously it can change. £20 billion this year is in the OBR forecast. So the OBR forecast is for £120 billion this year. So it varies month to month, depending on the profile, but about £10 billion per month.
Okay, thanks for that. Now, what Paul Johnson, of course, Director of Fiscal Studies, said was, and I quote, "What we're really doing is reaping the costs of a long-term failure to grow the economy, the effects of population ageing and high levels of past borrowing." And he concludes by saying, "We're in for a long, hard, unpleasant journey, a journey that's made more arduous than might have been by a series of economic own goals." So what could the UK government do differently, and what should the Scottish government do differently, in the view of the Institute of Fiscal Studies?
Perhaps I'll go first. Well, the biggest own goal this year is clearly a self-imposed fiscal crisis in the autumn, which it's very difficult to know precisely what lingering impacts that will have, but the clear risk is that we've had to do more painful tax rises and spending cuts than we otherwise would have done in a bid to try and repair our reputation. So I think the one clear lesson from that is that the messages that governments and chancellors send to the markets and to global investors matter. Doing a large package of unfunded tax cuts and then going out and briefing the papers that there's more to come and hinting about, you know, restricting the independence of the Bank of England, those things have consequences. And I think we've learned that this is part of adapting to a new world where interest rates are starting to rise again and money is no longer as cheap as it was. I think the one clear lesson is that a bit of policy stability and fiscal credibility and commitment to clear policies and principles, I think, are important. I think, as Paul, our director, said, this is partly the consequence of more than a decade, 15 years of abysmal growth and abysmal record on productivity. Now, I still think we don't understand well enough what's been driving that. And it's very easy to say the government should have done this, I should have done that. I think that's hard to say with certainty. I think what is clear in hindsight is that the cuts to things like capital investment after 2010 were very sharp and very deep. And that probably is part of, you know, that contributed to a weakening longer term outlook for the economy and for public services as well. If you think about investments in things like hospitals and schools and the public sector estate, I think the flip-flopping and constant changing of policy and lack of a sort of overall strategy on things like taxes doesn't help. I think that there's been a bit of a neglect of things like further education and adult education and skills. But, you know, there's all sorts of things easy to say with hindsight. But I think the big one is policy stability and commitment to sensible fiscal policy. Has been a clear lesson of the past few months that a recommitment to that is important, whether that's for the UK government or indeed for the Scottish government.
Okay, of course, the Scottish government hasn't got the same number of levers. That's why I was specifically saying what the Scottish government could do. Maybe, David, you could say what the Scottish government could do, perhaps, to given the situation that we're in. And
Yes, so I think, you know, as it stands in the kind of current constitutional settlement, you're right, the Scottish Government doesn't have the same sort of levers. So in effect, it can't sort of, you know, do the same things on borrowing and you know, it certainly can't do unfunded tax cuts in the same way the UK government can. In terms of the kind of lessons I think one can learn, though, from this, I think there are some for the kind of current constitutional settlement. And I think that one of those is around a strategy and prioritisation. The Scottish Government has a really ambitious set of reforms on welfare coming down the track. At the same time, it's got, you know, pressures on the NHS and many other public services, which in the spending review, squaring those two circles, you know, proved incredibly difficult in a Scottish context. So I think that one of the lessons here is that when one has to live in sort of, you know, a more constrained fiscal environment, I think one needs to kind of really think what one's priorities are. I hope that sort of in the kind of, you know, whether we see this in the upcoming Scottish Government's budget or, you know, in a sort of future reassessment of the spending review, we see a bit of grip on, well, look, actually, we can't potentially deliver all that we want given this fiscal environment. We need to actually have a strategy for that. Is that we prioritise certain elements of our sort of policy package? Is it the anti-child poverty element of it? What does that mean for pre-existing kind of areas where provision is greater in Scotland than the rest of the UK, like higher education, for example? Or do we look to taxes, Scottish taxes, to change the sort of funding envelope? I think there also are sort of implications, you know, for, I guess, not just within the current constitutional settlement, but, you know, if there are changes in the constitutional settlement, the Scottish Government, I think I said, made all the right noises around how it would approach public finances, you know, with, you know, fiscal rules, credibility, independent forecasters, so on, you know, not trashing sort of institutions like the UK government did to some extent. But whilst it made the right noises, there was a bit of a disconnect from that, and then some of the sort of suggestions on the policy side, which were potentially not consistent with that idea of fiscal sustainability. So I think one of the things that I've noticed by looking at the Scottish Government is that it's quite a broad coalition it pulls together, and therefore it needs to have a lot of different policies to satisfy that coalition. But that can sometimes mean a lack of focus on priorities. And when you're in a tight fiscal environment, whether as part of the UK or as an independent country, you would need to have a very strong prioritisation to really make sure you're delivering your key aims within a sort of a sustainable public finances.
Okay, just one more question from me, and it's about the block grant adjustments, OBR tax forecasts. We've already heard that we don't expect there to be much growth, if any, over the next few years. And indeed, we've heard about how living standards are going to fall. But the OBR has predicted that Scotland's income tax, for example, will grow from about just under 14.7 billion to just over 18.1 billion from the current financial year to 27-28. I mean, that's quite a huge increase. That's almost 3.4 billion pounds of an increase. I mean, is that? Do you see that coming through fiscal drag or other measures, David?
So, in terms of the forecasts for income tax, I mean, there's two that are relevant to the Scottish budget. One is the OBR's forecast for revenues in the rest of the UK. And the other is the SFC's forecast for Scottish revenues. Now, both of those will be increased over the next years because of fiscal drag, as you say. We're in a context where real earnings are falling, but nominal earnings are growing at a reasonably strong rate, actually. And, you know, in the combination of, you know, freezes in the personal allowance and the higher rate threshold, and then the subsequent reduction in the top rate threshold down to just over 125,000 in the rest of the UK, that does lead to quite substantial growth in revenues. Now, compared to the last set of forecasts, the big change has been that previously the OBR was forecast, well, the UK government had been planning to cut the basic rate to 19% in 2024-25. Liz Truss had planned to bring that forward, and then it's been abolished completely. And that will then, obviously, then mean that revenues are higher. You're not cutting tax rates in the rest of the UK. Revenues will be higher than previously forecast for that reason. And that offsets part, at least in the short term, maybe even all, and I haven't got the figures in front of me, of the sort of impact of the weaker economic outlook on revenues. Now, what that means is that compared to when the Scottish Government started a spending review, at that point, the Scottish Government was not, hadn't planned to cut its basic rate to 19p. So part of the funding available in 2024-25 onwards was due to the fact that at that point it was assumed the UK Government would cut income tax, but Scottish Government wouldn't. And that would mean that the block grant adjustment wouldn't grow as fast as Scottish revenues. That's no longer the case. And that means that, you know, even if the SFC, you know, projects forward, you know, it doesn't project a deterioration in Scottish underlying revenues relative to the rest of the UK, there's that policy effect, which will mean around £400 million needs to be found in subsequent years from the Scottish Government's budget, because that funding is no longer going to come through a smaller block grant adjustment.
OK, thank you very much. I don't know, Ben, do you want to make any further comment on that before I move on? No? OK.
No further comment, thanks.
Right, thank you very much. I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table. So the first person to ask a question will be Deputy Convener Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I actually want to just follow on that tax revenue point and block grant adjustments. There's been a bit of a recurring theme at this committee, looking at why we consistently have negative block grant adjustments, which is, you know, largely about the fiscal framework and kind of our per capita income tax receipt growth. Just given that the OBR projecting, you know, further negative block grant adjustments, I just wondered if there is any further insight to be drawn as to why our income tax receipt growth is slower in Scotland, or if there's any further detail, given that it's just so critical to our understanding of public finances in Scotland.
Yes, I'll address that question. So the SFC has looked into this, and the Scottish Government has looked into this to some extent in their previous reports. And I think historically, one of the factors underlying the slower growth in the Scottish tax base than the RUK tax base, and hence Scottish revenues not keeping up with the BGA, has been that a lot of the growth in the UK tax base has come from higher earners, especially those based in the southeast of England and London. And the Scottish Government did some analysis where if you strip out London and the southeast, Scottish trends look much more similar to the rest of, you know, England and Northern Ireland, so the Midlands, the North, and Northern Ireland. And another factor historically seems to have been the underperformance of tax revenues in the northeast of Scotland, around Aberdeenshire, related to the oil industry. And again, if you strip that out, that seems to reduce it. Now, that was historically what was going on. Now, looking ahead, I'm not sure that would necessarily be such a big explanation. Because of the freezes in the thresholds and so on, that tends to actually raise more, relatively speaking, from the lower part of the income distribution, which there is more of in Scotland, because a freeze in the threshold matters more to the relative amount of tax you pay, you know, the lower down the income distribution you are. So I don't think that sort of what's happening at the top part of the distribution could be quite as important looking ahead as it has been historically. The SFC suggested that there's two factors at play. It is less optimistic about what's going to happen to Scottish employment rates than in the rest of the UK. And it links part of that to ageing, but actually it's not all ageing. Some of it is to do with lower employment rates amongst, you know, younger adults as well. I've not looked at the figures more recently since the last SFC report to see if that's been borne out or whether that was just a difference in judgment between the SFC and the OBR.
Thank you. I mean, I just think this is an issue that's important to keep a bit of a watching brief on. I've got a couple of questions really about measures and potentially a bit of sort of economic structure. Firstly, on measures, I mean, we are seeing very sharp inflation, but it's also being driven by very specific things, a combination of increase in wholesale gas prices, which is being experienced across the world. I mean, likewise, the war in Ukraine, you know, both as an event, but actually critically given the importance of Ukraine in terms of some basic agricultural goods, you know, such as sunflower oil, is having very particular impacts. So we're seeing very sharp inflation, but it's also lopsided. So we're seeing, you know, particular goods such as, I think, skim milk is one of the highest, the goods that have experienced the highest inflation, around 30%. Do we need some better measures? Because not all people will buy the same basket of goods, and particularly governments don't buy the same basket of goods as people do. So therefore, to get a true grasp of how much the government spending power and people's spending power has been reduced, do we need to have some better measures for these sorts of things so we can understand how much money we have to spend?
If I might come in first on the point around inflation measures, I'm sure Ben will add a lot here. The GDP deflator is one of his interests. But in terms of measures across, you know, the impacts on households, first point I would add is that whilst initially at least the increases in prices were very highly concentrated, one of the worrying signs we've seen is that sort of inflation is now being leaking out across broader categories of goods. It's not as concentrated in just food and energy as it once was. You're seeing it increase across a wider range of goods and services. Sort of core inflation, stripping those out, is starting to, you know, rise, and that could lead to worries about, you know, will higher inflation be more difficult to address than the OBR and the Bank of England hope it would, once it starts affecting inflation expectations and things beyond energy and food. Second on sort of broader inflation is that the ONS has started to kind of, you know, produce a wider basket of inflation measures that try to kind of look at whether or not, you know, price increases are, you know, particularly high for the basic products as opposed to kind of the, you know, the Tesco value as opposed to the Tesco finest and so on. We are having more measures there. In terms of government inflation, the cost for government, traditionally the way this is measured is using the GDP deflator. And that has been moving in some rather odd ways in the last couple of years. I think there probably is the case that when considering what the real terms change in government spending power is, if one is thinking about the inputs that government can purchase from those funding, we potentially do need a new inflation measure. I'll pass over to Ben, who can say a lot more about that issue.
Thanks, David. On the first part of your question, yeah, as David said, core inflation is now running well above target. And if you just look at what's happening to average earnings, I think at like 6% across the UK as a whole, average cash earnings growth, that it's hard to reconcile that with, you know, inflation at 2% target. So inflation is sort of, it's right through the economy now, probably running at more than 2% across all sorts of goods and services. And that's probably what the Bank of England is most focused on when it's thinking about its interest rate decisions. I think you're absolutely right that we don't have a great measure of what's happening to the cost of running public services. For example, we have traditionally relied on the GDP deflator, which is a measure of domestic economy-wide inflation. Now, the reason why that matters at the moment is because a domestic measure of inflation won't include rising prices of imports. We import lots of food and lots of gas, so those things don't enter the GDP deflator. So that's been running much lower than CPI, for example, CPI being a measure of the rate of inflation facing households. Now, the tricky thing is that I think CPI isn't a good measure of the inflation rate facing, for example, hospitals and schools. Gas and food and fuel represent a much bigger fraction of a household's budget than they do of a hospital or a GP practice or a nursery. Staffing costs clearly enter much more prominently into the running costs of public services. So to some extent, it's determined by government pay decisions. I do think that it would be a really valuable thing for, say, the ONS to try and construct some measure of sort of a, almost like a public sector inflation measure. There used to be a health sector specific one that was discontinued in around 2015. I think the evidence base here is lacking a little bit. And when you're making assessments of what's happening to real terms value of grant funding or of budgets, it really matters which inflation measure you use. I think the quote unquote true rate of inflation faced by public services probably lies somewhere between CPI and the GDP deflator, but precisely where it's a matter of judgment. And I think this is lacking, and I think this is something where there could be usefully work done by some of the government's statistical agencies.
Just a final question. I'm just going to slightly conflate two slightly different issues, but I think it all comes down to the same point about how do we gain a better understanding both of inflation and our lack of growth. And I think there are some things that we don't have an accurate insight or measure of. So the first is that we still have relatively higher energy prices, especially electricity generation, compared to the rest of Europe. And that doesn't entirely make sense to me, especially if you compare directly with other countries with similar energy production composition, such as the Netherlands. So the electricity prices in the Netherlands are about 20% lower than they are in the UK. So do we need to look more, given how expensive the energy intervention is, do we need to look more carefully in terms of comparing what we have done in this country in terms of the price cap with other countries and why? Because I can understand why different countries might be different if they've got different compositions in terms of their energy production or indeed consumption. But the Netherlands is very comparable to the UK, both in terms of its economic mix and production. Do we need to look more carefully at that and indeed try to measure that, given it's becoming so critical? And likewise, Ben, you said that we don't quite know why we've had a lack of growth in the last 10 years. But I mean, I think broadly stated, we do know that the fundamental problem we have in the UK is a lack of investment, both government and private sector investment. Do we need to measure that more carefully, more precisely? I mean, and that you hinted at your previous answer that the cuts in capital investments have been one of the things that... So do we need to measure our energy market more closely? Do we need to measure investment? Would they help our fiscal position if we understood those things better?
I think that's right. I think what, you know, the famous management consultant maxim, what you can measure is what you can manage. I do think there is definitely some truth to that. I mean, I should say we're not, neither David nor I are energy market experts. I would say that given the huge sums being spent, there is clearly a need that even small changes that might help increase energy efficiency, for example, or might improve the functioning of the electricity market, those things have the potential to save large sums. And I gather the government is, you know, doing work on market reform of the electricity sector, but I'm not an expert. I don't have much to offer. On the latter point, yeah, so measuring investment, we do know that we can see, we have the data to measure and see that UK business investment has lagged other developed countries for quite some time. We can see that government investment has also lagged other countries for quite some time. We can measure that and observe that. I think that, you know, getting very granular data can perhaps sometimes be difficult. And I think it's very difficult to identify the effects of things like that, that are very slow moving and the effects don't come for a long time. And there's lots of other things going on in the background. It's very difficult to precisely identify the impacts of these things. But there's definitely a consensus that high levels of investment might have been good for growth, particularly in certain sectors. And I think that better measurement is part of the answer, but also it just has to be a question of priorities and of, I think, policy stability. When it comes to things like corporate taxation and trying to encourage business investment, there's a lack of a clear overall strategy, I think, and that would be just as beneficial as better management and measurement, I think.
I think abolishing the transmission charges imposed on Scotland by the last Labour government would also help. David, do you want to come in?
Yes, I might come in just very briefly. On the point about energy, as Ben said, the UK government is planning reforms to the energy market. Now, one of these reforms would, in effect, be splitting the market, if you like. So rather than being one marginal price that determines the kind of like price of all electricity, which is usually the most expensive one at any one point, so currently gas, there would be, for example, long-term contracts for renewables at a lower price, and then, you know, there'd still be a marginal one to make sure you you know, didn't run out of supply, again, that could be at gas as it is now, but they'd have set foot prices in the market. That could end up reducing the overall average price, and, you know, you wouldn't have a situation where when the gas price is very high, you've got windfall profits for renewables producers. Now, the reason I just throw that in a little bit of detail is I think that will actually have an implication for public sector and other organisations which currently say they want to use, you know, renewable energy. In a world where you have two separate prices, consumers will not be able to choose to use renewable energy, because otherwise they'd all choose to use the low price one. But in future, there'll be no such thing if we have this split market of having renewable energy only contracts. You'll have to have some bundle of energy that everyone buys from. So whilst you're splitting up the energy market to have different prices, you're actually bundling it together when it comes to consumers and businesses buying that energy, so that they can't undermine that splitting of the price by all piling into the low cost one. So energy market reform is potentially useful, but it does mean some changes to kind of how people have got used to, particularly people that think, oh, I'm being green, I'm buying green energy. If you try to change the prices, you can't do that in future.
Thank you very much. I'm going to just say very finally to Ben that the you can't manage what you don't measure is one of my absolute favourite sayings. So thank you very much for repeating it. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. List to be followed by John.
I wonder if I could ask a technical question on the back of commentary from some economists that following the end of lockdown and the very severe restrictions that we all faced when it came to not being able to do other things, is there any evidence that you can put your finger on that the service industries are beginning to be rebooted a bit more successfully than other areas of the economy because we're now out and about wanting to take advantage of services that we couldn't before? Do you have any data that suggests that that is accurate, or is it too early to tell?
There's a really interesting story here contrasting the UK and Europe with the US. So in the UK, clearly during lockdown, there was a sort of swing away from services, restaurants and so on, towards goods. But what's interesting is that in the UK and Europe, that has sort of normalized again, back to both goods and services are sort of back towards the pre-pandemic trajectory, and sort of the mix hasn't permanently shifted. In the US, that shift has lasted, and that lasting increase in demand for goods and less demand for services there is part of what was driving US inflation higher earlier than it was here, and that's sort of partly that reconfiguration in the States has been more difficult, exacerbated and worsened by global supply chain disruptions. But I think in the UK, the evidence is that the mix of goods and services is more back to where it was. I think the more lasting impact has been where people spend their money. So there's some great data on using credit card transactions and things like that. And you can see less spending in city centres and more spending in the commuter towns around and around where people live and now spend more time if they're working remotely. So I think that geographical shift is potentially the more lasting one than the mix of goods and services.
And just...
It's coming to me. Yeah, so the only point I would add there is that there was just some BBC research published the day I noticed that looked at the changes in the high street across the UK, and it suggests that within services, there has been a little bit of a shift, at least in the high street, on who's occupying properties. So actually, maybe somewhat surprisingly, there's been an increase in the number of pubs, you know, the first time in a long time, and, you know, restaurants and cafes, I think it was beauty parlours and tattoo surgeries as well. And then shops, banks and other things have changed. Now, that means that actually, you know, apart from pubs, where that is a little bit of a reversal, what we've seen is a bit of a continuation of the trends we saw before the pandemic, where, you know, the move to online retail, online banking has meant shops and banks are still sort of closing down, but actually high streets and commercial areas are kind of reorienting towards sort of experiences and sort of personal services like, you know, restaurants, cafes, beauty parlors and so on.
I heard that interview too, and I thought it was interesting, but they were also flagging up that there are regional differences in the way that people are reacting to their local high street, which I think is potentially a bit of a worry as well. Just on the back of that, obviously there are different factors that affect inflation. It's either demand push or demand pull, or that's cost push scenario. Is it your understanding that it is very much the cost push problem that we've had, whether that's from supplies from Ukraine or obviously the huge hike in energy prices? Is it your understanding that the greater component of driving high inflation just now has been more on that cost push side than it has on the demand pull side?
If I may come in first and then hand over to Ben, that would be my understanding, that you know the big drivers of inflation have been the sort of supply shock both to food and energy, and to some extent previously it had been sort of supply chain issues. However, it is also the case we've had a really quite tight labour market, and I think we have seen wage pressures creep up as well, not as fast as, you know, they've not been keeping pace with the prices, but they've certainly, you know, risen substantially. And within certain subsectors, you did see some very substantial increases in wages. So my own view would be that it's been largely a supply side driven inflation shock, but that actually demand has been relatively robust, and that might have sort of meant this has become more entrenched than it otherwise would have been.
I'm just asking the question because obviously what we've suffered is a sort of pulling in opposite directions between fiscal policy and monetary policy that the UK government has been desperately trying, perhaps not very successfully at one stage, to get the right balance on the fiscal policy, whereas the whole remit for the Bank of England has to control inflation, therefore the monetary policy has been pulling in an opposite direction. And asking the question as to whether, because of that difficulty, it really matters what kind of inflation it is in order to determine what kind of policies are put into practice.
That's a really interesting question. Let me just think about that for one second. If Ben's got a thought already formed, he can come in, but let me have just a think on that for a second.
Yeah, sure. I think that clearly the disconnect between fiscal and monetary policy was greatest in September, around the time of the so-called mini budget. I think what's really difficult here is that for the most of the past decade, I think you could have made quite a strong argument that a mix, like a slightly looser fiscal policy and slightly tighter monetary policy, might have been a better policy mix. You could have had, rather than conducting such a sharp period of austerity, you could have had slightly higher interest rates. I think that argument that has almost flipped this year as interest rates have started to rise and inflation globally has gone up. I think that the Bank of England, to sort of go to your previous question a little bit, clearly this inflation episode has its origins in global energy markets, a global supply side cost push shock. But the danger that I think the Bank of England worry about is that becoming embedded in wage expectations, and particularly looking at an economy without a great amount of spare capacity or slack. Now, that's worsened by the fact that the labour force is shrinking because of rising rates of inactivity and so on. But it's not as though we've got very high levels of unemployment. And so I think there's a concern that what starts as a sort of cost push episode can become embedded in expectations and become much harder try and squeeze out. But I think you're right, and the policy mix does matter a lot here, and there's a delicate balancing act to be struck, and the degree of coordination between the two. Seemingly one of the motivations behind the Sunak and Hunt sort of policy response when they came into government was the more tightening we do, the less interest rate rises the Bank of England will have to do. But then, the Bank of England know that and take that into account in their policymaking process. So it gets complicated. And without that explicit coordination, you can risk a disconnect between the two. But I think your question frame is exactly the right one.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, thank you very much. John, to be followed by Ross.
Thanks, Convener. I'm interested in the level of interest rates, because the feeling is that they are high at the moment at 4%, but they're considerably lower than inflation. And, I mean, if that was to continue long term, would everybody not just borrow and make a profit? I mean, are we just in an unusual situation at the moment, or could it continue long term that inflation is higher than the interest rates?
Well, you're right. So there's a concept in economics called the real interest rate, which basically is, you know, the nominal interest rate minus inflation. And clearly at the moment, inflation is higher than nominal interest rates. So we have negative real interest rates. And in, you know, in normal times, you'd expect that to be a stimulus to economic activity. But the Bank of England expects inflation to fall back over the next few years as hopefully gas prices start to fall and as their monetary policy tightening feeds through. And so in a few years' time, they expect interest rates, or the markets expect interest rates to be a little bit higher, but the bank have been signaling that maybe interest rates of about 3% might be what we'd expect. And as inflation falls back, indeed, under the OBR forecast, CPI is set to turn negative. So I think in a few years' time, we will no longer be in a situation of negative real interest rates. But it's also, if you look at the period of the past, you know, this period of low interest rates we've just lived through, we've consistently had Bank of England base rate at, you know, a fraction of a percent, and inflation much higher. So we've had negative real interest rates for the past 10 years, and it hasn't necessarily been the case that we've had a, you know, a borrowing fueled boom. That wasn't enough to stimulate a massive period of economic expansion. So it's clearly not the only thing that matters. I hope that addresses your question.
It still puzzles me slightly, but I accept there's not a clear-cut answer to it. Liz Smith was asking, you know, about the prices and the gas and the food were driving inflation and so on. I was just wondering, you know, can we compare that to other countries? Are other countries, in Western countries especially, in much the same position, or is it differing? Is there much difference in either the inflation level or the reasons for inflation in neighbouring countries, similar countries?
If I might come on that one first, and I might come back to some of your previous questions there, John. So on that kind of latest question, there is a range of inflation rates across developed countries. The UK's rate is sort of reasonably high by sort of, you know, Northwestern European standards, although Germany's has been creeping up as well. It's somewhat lower than most of those in Central and Eastern Europe. The factors driving them in Europe have been, you know, energy prices to a large extent, with differences to some extent being driven by differences in their energy mix and differences in their policy response to the energy crisis. In the US, energy hasn't been such a big issue in their inflation increase, and hence their inflation actually peaked earlier and it seems to be coming down now. More important for them was sort of supply constraints. As Ben said, this sort of excess demand for goods relative to services and oil prices and hence petrol and secondhand cars, actually, which was a bit of a factor in the UK at one stage as well, but I think it sort of moved out the system. So the UK is seeing quite similar factors to the rest of Europe, but the impacts are varying to some extent based on the policy response, the energy mix, and there'll be other factors, you know, like currency movements and other things there as well. I think in many parts of Eastern Europe where they don't use the euro, a depreciation of their currency has also pushed up inflation. That probably was pushing up inflation in the UK as well, although the pound has regained a lot of the ground it lost previously, so that might actually got to pull down a bit on inflation going forwards. On the sort of previous questions about the nature of the current shock and the policy response to it. The only point I'll add to what Ben made earlier is that if this was a supply shock hitting a time when we had significant spare capacity in the economy, well, you may not need such a large, monetary policy or even fiscal policy response to that, because you'd expect, you know, with a lot of slack, that the higher inflation would be less likely to translate into, you know, higher wage growth and then hence sort of a wage price spiral. When you've got a tight labour market and a supply shock, I think that means you need to be a bit more aggressive on your policy response to bring inflation down.
Okay, thanks for that. And the other area I just wanted to touch on was, my understanding is that the OBR forecasts assume quite a big increase in fuel duty next April. And the suggestion was that if that doesn't go ahead, there could be a £6 billion hole in the finances. Can you say anything about that?
Yeah, I can start. So the OBR are required by law to take government policy as stated. It is government policy for fuel duty to go up next year. Clearly, the sensible bet would be that it will not, given the experience of the past decade and the state that UK household finances are in. So we should expect that not to go ahead. That would create a hole in their plans. It would be, they've currently got about £10 billion of headroom against their fiscal targets, but wouldn't by itself be enough to put them on track to miss those. But it would clearly matter. And I think that's just one of many, it's what we call policy risks, that the OBR aren't allowed to or able to take into account. So things like tax rises that you've promised that don't go ahead, or spending cuts you've promised that don't go ahead. Those things are built into the public finance projections produced by the OBR. But if you look at the how tight spending plans look after the next general election and what that might imply for areas like local government in England, I just think it's very difficult to see how they might actually be implemented in their current state. And so you might think that plans will change. I think fuel duty is very much in that camp. It seems almost certain that that won't go ahead.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Ross?
Thanks. I hope you don't mind me jumping around between a few different areas. First, just to follow John's line of questioning around inflation, I'd be interested in your thoughts on debt interest. It feels like the era of cheap money is over globally, at least for now, but the UK obviously went through a very particular episode with debt interest rates off the back of the mini budget. What is your expectation of the rates over the next couple of years?
I'll take that one first. So the Bank of England have done some internal modelling, and they think that there is a UK-specific element to this. So interest rates are rising globally, but according to their model, we've had interest rates rise even more because of some sort of UK component of what how the market are treating UK government debt. In terms of what happens next, it's really important here to think about the OBR take market expectations, so the what the market as a whole on average think are going to happen to the Bank of England base rate. Now, the Bank of England have been signalling quite strongly, basically saying to the market, rates are not going to rise as much as you think they are. And so they've been producing scenarios like forecasts for the economy, one that's predicated on market expectations for interest rates and one that's predicated on interest rates going to 3% and then staying there. And they're sort of quite clearly signaling that they think that they won't have to go as high as the markets think. Now, that matters a lot for the UK's public finances. The OBR take market expectations. If instead interest rates don't go up by that much, the public finances will be in a better position. And one reason why this matters a lot in the UK is the interaction between quantitative easing and the government's debt interest bill. So to simplify what's quite a complicated story, basically now increases in the Bank of England interest rate, base rate, feed through very quickly through to higher debt interest bill because of the fact that the bank is holding large amounts of gilts on its balance sheet. And so what happens to those interest rates matters an enormous amount for how much you have to spend on debt interest and therefore how much you have available for other things. So this is a really important question, and it's going to matter a lot for how fiscally tight things feel over the next few years, and whether the market turns out to be right or not will be enormously important.
Thanks very much. And jumping to a completely different area and taking on board what I can't remember what one of you said a moment ago, that neither of you are energy policy experts. I'm interested if you are aware of any work that's been done around the impact of the loopholes to the windfall tax. I think Shell were the most recent company to report that they've managed to avoid paying any of the windfall tax as a result of their North Sea exploration activities giving them sufficient relief from it. Are you aware of any work that's been done to identify whether the loophole to the tax is creating incentive for companies to pursue further exploration that they hadn't planned previous to the introduction of the windfall tax?
So I might come there briefly, and I might actually circle back to your previous question if I might as well, Zoe. So on that, I'm not aware of any specific work on that. I was aware of I think Shell being saying that they did not expect to pay it this year. They did expect to pay it in subsequent years. I think BP do expect to pay it this year and in future years. And you're right that that is related to investment. But I think it was a feature of the scheme that they wanted to not only offset the effect of the higher tax on investment, but actually to potentially encourage investment overall. I think that was, you know, maybe not fully stated, but it was seen as a way to increase the supply of domestically provided oil and gas and make us less dependent on international markets. And I think you can debate whether that is a good or bad policy, you know, related to either energy security and prices, or, you know, the need to transition away from oil and gas, you know, for net zero. I wouldn't want to say there's no analysis looking at this, but it's not something that I'm aware of. On your previous question, if I may, there's actually an interesting interaction here between the OBR and the Bank of England. So the OBR's forecasts build in sort of market expectations about what would happen to interest rates. The Bank of England has signalled that it thinks that might be too high, but that's based on the Bank of England having a quite pessimistic outlook for the economy. Now, if the economy turns out to be stronger than expected by the Bank of England, then it may not be the case that the market expectations are too high for interest rates. Maybe the Bank of England will have to go higher than it thinks it does, because the economy will hold up more strongly, and hence it could end up being in closer to the market expectations. So I'm not sure I've made a very coherent point there, but the point I'm trying to make is that we have forecasts for the fiscal side of the equation being done by one forecaster, forecasts for the monetary side of the equation being done by another forecaster, and where they have different judgments about the sort of state of the economy, that might lead to policy not being, if you like, optimally aligned between the two sides of the equation. Because if the OBR, if the Bank of England assumes that the economy will be weaker than it actually turns out to be, and for example, the OBR assumes that it will be stronger than it turns out to be, that could lead to mismatches in policy. And we see that to some extent also in the Scottish context, where the SFC and the OBR make, you know, forecasts on different sides of the revenues equation. So I do think there's like an interesting issue there about, how forecasters communicate with each other. Because on the one hand, you don't want them to kind of share too much, because you don't want groupthink. You do want to have different opinions and different insights in the economy. But then if policies and if forecasts are being made fundamentally on different judgments, that can sometimes lead to policies not aligning or forecasts not aligning, and that having knock-on effects to fiscal policy.
Thanks very much. That was really interesting points. I appreciate you circling back to it. I've just got one last question on a different area again, on the lowering threshold of the top rate of income tax. When that has been considered in the passed in Scotland or proposed, there was two recent tax papers out by the SDUC and the IPPR proposing stuff in this area. The counter argument has been that it would result in significant behaviour change and not actually raise additional revenue. Now, part of that argument is that any Scotland specific reduction in the threshold could result in those on higher income simply moving elsewhere in the UK to avoid paying that. If we're to assume that the Scottish Government will follow the UK Government's lead in reducing to 125,000, that element of behaviour change would be eliminated, but there would still be the prospect of people that converting their income into other forms to avoid paying it through income tax. Do you have any expectations around behaviour change and tax avoidance in this area? It's not an argument that I have to say I've ever found massively credible, but I would be interested in your thoughts on it.
If I might come on that question first. Previously, the Scottish Government has looked at these issues, and it has said that it thinks there's actually two factors that it sort of is concerned about. One is migration to the rest of the UK, and the second is that Scottish tax rate changes only apply to non-savings, non-dividends income, and hence a change in the Scottish rate opens up a bigger gap, if you like, between the Scottish earned income rate and the dividends income tax rate, and you might get sort of additional avoidance in that. Now, if it happens across the UK as a whole, as you say, migration within the UK is not an issue, although there could still be international migration. The issue about shifting to dividends income would depend on whether or not they're also, you know, increasing the sort of dividends rate over that range of 125 to 150,000 pounds. I think they would, because by reducing the threshold for the additional rate of tax, there's a linked additional rate of dividends tax as well. So I think that will be coming down as well. So I don't think that gap would open up. But overall, I would say that the scope or whilst it would still be behavioural response if Scotland were to follow suit now, it would be substantially reduced because the migration angle's closed, and whilst there still is that gap between dividends tax and earned income tax, the gap I don't think would be larger than it is now, because I think the dividend income tax will be coming up alongside the UK rates of tax on this income range. In terms of, you know, the scale of behaviour response, I think the forecasts by the HMRC and sort of vetted by OBR for this to raise about 800 million across England and Northern Ireland and Wales. That would build in a substantial amount of behavioural response. I've actually not looked at what elasticities have assumed and what the sort of pre behavioural response revenues would be, but it wouldn't surprise me if they're 2 to 3 times larger than that. In a Scottish case, you know, I would expect a similar measure in Scotland, given the taxable capacity of Scotland to raise probably around 30 to 40 million pounds off the top of my head. Now, an interesting thing, I think, is that Scotland actually could lose from this policy overall, though, because the block grant adjustment will go up, reflecting the percentage change in this in the rest of the UK. Now, because there's more higher income earners in England and particularly London and the South East, there'll be a bigger percentage change in revenues in England and Northern Ireland than you'll get from the same tax change in Scotland. So if Scotland's to follow suit with this tax change, I think Scotland might lose a few million pounds because the block grant will go up by more than the tax revenues in Scotland.
I think you've hit on one of the key areas that the review of the fiscal framework really needs to consider there, the perverse incentives that it currently creates. That's all from me, Convener. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Ross. Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. We're starting to see house prices fall. What impact is that going to have on the UK economy and also the Scottish budget in terms of, is it just going to be a reduction in LBTT, or could we see a block grant adjustment around that, or where do you see that going?
If I might come on the sort of revenue side of things, and if Ben has some points to add on the broader economy. So in terms of the impact on the Scottish budget, it will depend on the relative impacts of this on revenues. So the fall in house prices, and particularly actually the fall in transactions volumes, will reduce revenues from LBTT. It will also reduce revenues from stamp duty land tax in the rest of the UK. So there'll be lower revenues, but also a lower block grant adjustment. Now, which of those outweighs each other, and hence the net impact on the Scottish budget is uncertain. I think it will depend on a couple of factors. The first is which part of the market is most affected by the slowdown in transactions. If it's the top of the market, well, on the one hand, that's a bigger share of the market in England and Northern Ireland, you know, because of London mainly. But on the other hand, the Scottish Government has a much more progressive structure of the tax system. So, you know, conditional upon the distribution of property values, you know, more comes from the top part in Scotland because of the higher tax rates. If it's at the bottom of the market, then actually, you know, more of that is in Scotland, but Scotland has lower rates on the very bottom of the market. So I think the picture of the net impact will be really quite complicated to predict. It will depend very much on which parts of the market are hit most and whether the sort of the distribution of Scottish prices being lower outweighs the tax rate being more progressive or vice versa. So I don't want to make an accurate prediction there, but just to say there will be a change in the block grant adjustment, whether it partially offsets or more than offsets the fall in revenues in Scotland. It's difficult to see at this stage without further sort of in-depth analysis. On the second point around how will this affect the wider economy, well, property, there'll be two effects that will affect the wider economy. First of all, there might be a wealth effect, so that lower property prices mean that people feel less wealthy. That could translate into lower consumer spending. There is evidence that, you know, the wealth effect of property prices does matter for consumer spending, at least to some extent. The other is that property transactions are associated with activity around, you know, improvements and new white goods and you know, new furnitures and so on. So there could be an impact on the retail sector and on the building sector.
Second question I had was around the energy price cap. Obviously, that's quite an expensive scheme for the government to run. Is there equivalent schemes in other parts of the world?
There are equivalent schemes in other countries. So, for example, I'm not sure what the state is now, but France, for a long time, was capping its increase in electricity to, I think, 4%. One of the reasons why French inflation remains so low. To some extent, they could do that because lots of their energy is nuclear and is state-owned. And effectively, they were sort of, you know, rather than having a windfall tax, basically the windfall tax was being captured by the state-owned enterprise anyway. Other countries have adopted different schemes. You know, I think Austria has quite a generous scheme. Germany has a scheme which does significantly reduce energy prices, but unlike a cap, it doesn't completely cap them at the margin, so that it still does allow some impact of the higher marginal price to fall through to consumers and businesses, so they still have a stronger incentive to cut back their energy use. So there are different schemes in different countries. If it's of interest, some colleagues of mine actually produced some figures about how much energy bills might increase for different types of households over the next 6 months. And I can either send those to you afterwards, or I could even state some the record here, if that's useful.
Yeah, it'd be helpful.
Should I forward them or should I state them?
Just offline would be great.
Great.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I mean, one of the interesting things I find about the autumn statement was that the UK government decided to close Office of Tax Simplification. I'm just wondering what the reason for that was and what the impact would be, because obviously that's something that's not been reversed by the new Chancellor.
That was something I was aware of. It's not something I've actually looked into into detail about what the stated reason was. I think it is a disappointment that it has been abolished. I think that whilst the office perhaps didn't have as substantial effect on simplifying taxes and particularly kind of seeing where, you know, you could reduce the discrepancies between tax treatments of similar activities than we would have hoped at the IFS. It still did play at least some role in sort of ensuring issues of simplicity, issues of interactions were taken account of. So I think it is disappointing that it was abolished and has not been sort of resurrected. I don't know if Ben has anything further to add.
Yeah, it just seems...
Nothing further.
Yeah, it just seems that, you know, an office that tries to make taxes simpler and more understandable, it seems to be quite a positive thing, I would have thought. One of the things that the OBR mentioned, and it's been touched on only peripherally, is really unemployment. And the OBR expects unemployment to rise across the UK by 3.6% to 4.9% by 2024. Now, that's going to be quite a significant part of the workforce, in excess of 1.5 million. I'm just wondering what the regional impacts might be of that and how you anticipate that will impact on Scotland. Either of you? Ben?
Sure, I can go. I haven't looked in detail. My first instinct would be that a lot of this will depend on industrial position and which sectors are particularly hard hit over the next few years, whether that's energy intensive sectors, whether that's manufacturing. Clearly that will have a different geographical footprint depending on where they expect an employment rise most. I think that there's, you know, this interacts with this broad question of having a tight labour market and having a potentially a shrinking workforce and the impact that rising unemployment will have on wage demands and on the promise of industrial action. I think all of this interacts. I'm afraid I don't have any particularly well-informed views on how Scottish unemployment might fare relative to the rest of the UK.
I mean, even in the broadest sense, I mean, if we have 1.6, 1.7 million unemployed and about 5 million people economically inactive, that's clearly going to have a major impact on growth and productivity, is it not? And tax revenues.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's all part of a sort of weakening, weakening demand, of course, if you've got more people out of work or inactive. But it's also, I think, the more concerning thing is what this implies for the productive potential of the economy. If we had people who previously we might have expected to carry on working for another 10 years more, or even we've seen lots of young people dropping out and claiming disability benefits, for example. Those are all people who aren't going to be productively contributing to UK production in the same way. And that clearly raises concerns. And I think that's why this health here is clearly a major input into productivity and into our, you know, economic prospects. And I think that that's what's really concerning at the moment is that the growing body of evidence suggesting that the health of the UK population and workforce has worsened. And what does that imply for growth rates and so on going forward and tax revenues? That absolutely should be an area of focus for policy, I think.
David, you wanted to come in?
Yes, if I might make two brief points. The first on Scotland, which is that generally during an economic downturn, you'd expect that areas which have a higher reliance in the public sector tend to see less of a fall in employment because the public sector employment is less cyclical than the private sector employment. Now, whether that's the case going forwards is less clear, though, because with a sort of a fixed budget, a constrained budget and higher pressures on wages, well, one of the only ways, you know, you can address that, apart from, say, either increasing taxes or cutting social security spending, is to cut the public sector headcount. And I'm aware that already in the spending review, the Scottish Government was penciling in, you know, cuts to the public sector headcount in order to sort of make those figures match. You know, if inflation is higher and wage growth is higher than was previously expected and the budgets are not increased, that could put further downwards pressure on the public sector headcount, which already looked challenging to deliver in the context of, you know, the demands being placed on public services. So that was a sort of Scotland-specific point. The sort of broader point that comes back to sort of, you know, what this sort of employment and particularly inactivity means for the economy. Well, during the 2010s, increases in economic activity was one of the actually a notable bright spot in the economy. We saw quite a substantial increase in employment during the 2010s, and that actually masked the, you know, to some extent, the poor productivity performance. If going forwards we don't see, you know, we see either even just a pausing of that increase in activity, or a reversal and a rise in inactivity, that means that productivity growth will be even more important for economic growth going forwards.
Okay, and I mean, Nelly, you talked about the changing public service footprint, if you like, relative to pre-pandemic. Now, what do you think the impact will be on the Scottish budget of that? And the reason I'm asking specifically is that I read at the weekend that, well, the number of passengers on buses is still below pre-pandemic. It is perhaps approaching 90% of what it was before, but rail passenger numbers are barely 50% of what they were before the pandemic, and the Scottish Government, I believe, spends somewhere just over £1.5 billion in subsidising railways in Scotland. So quite clearly, one would anticipate that there will have to be a significant increase in further public support for that, or a reduction in services. And that, of course, has knock-on effects, as does indeed reliability because of strikes or shortage of staff or whatever, in terms of switching people from cars into the public sector. So what do you feel the impact's likely to be, David, of the kind of impact of the pandemic on transport, public transport, as we go forward?
If I come on the kind of Scotland-specific points first, so it's actually interesting. One of the savings that the Scottish Government found in this year's budget was actually a result of lower bus usage. It was less spending on concessionary fares. So in the short term, for buses at least, you might save some money with lower usage. But of course, if there's lower usage more generally, some services may become unviable. And if you want to maintain them, you might need higher subsidies for bus services. I think by far a bigger issue is rail services, which saw very, very substantial increases in state support during the pandemic. And the UK government has been trying to unwind that. And that's one of the reasons why the reduction in state support at the same time as the passenger numbers have not fully come back, I think is one of the reasons why we're potentially seeing some issues in the rail industry around industrial relations, because there's clearly a sort of potential shortfall of income there that operators are trying to make up for, and one way they can do that is through rationalising, expenses, including labour expenses. How significant this will be for Scotland going forwards, I think will depend, one, on, do we see a further increase in, do we see it come back a bit more in terms of passenger numbers? And secondly, does the Scottish Government shift the mix a bit in terms of the funding for Scottish Rail? Scottish Rail has, I think, got the highest ratio of subsidy to passenger fee income, largely because it's serving a large network with a sparse population. But there may need to be a look at that as well. I don't know if Ben has any kind of comments on the broader UK-wide figures on the kind of
down. Just, I guess, one quick big picture point here is that this is true of railways, it's true of the NHS, it's true of, I think, of the education system as well. Is, I think early on there was clearly a hope that COVID represented a one-off, time-limited shock that we had to provide support to get through, and then things would sort of return back to normal. But I think what's becoming clearer, in some settings, is that actually COVID's more of a persistent, a permanent shock to, whether that be to passenger numbers, whether that be to health service productivity. And it might mean that we have to provide more funding, like persistently, indefinitely, just to get the same level of service. That might mean more public subsidies for buses or for railways. It might mean we have to spend more on the health service to get the same volume of care because of the hit to productivity that infection control measures take, for example. And I think that long lasting impact of COVID is going to have an impact on public services, and that's something that all levels of government are going to have to grapple with. I think it's really difficult.
Okay, I'm just going to let Michelle in, but in terms of the kind of young person's concessionary fare, a lot of that, the money that was unspent was, of course, switched to bus services in the summer to ensure that services didn't actually fold. I mean, that actually was the case indeed in my own constituency with regard to some local services. Michelle?
Hi. Yeah, I just wanted to go back to the point that the convener raised about the Office of Tax Simplification. I mean, there have been some big numbers bandied around today about the kind of black hole, £6 billion black hole, and the fuel duty escalator, £10 billion per month on debt interest. But the combined figure of loss due to money laundering plus fraud, the National Crime Agency estimates is about £100 billion each and every year lost to the UK, and also roughly, I mean, figures vary, about £190 billion each and every year because of fraud. I mean, that on a scale, these figures are utterly staggering. So I suppose my question to you then, in terms of the IFS, might you consider looking much more actively at that, given that there's almost a shadow economy running here, and if there's no appetite from the UK government in terms of getting rid of the Office of Tax Simplification, because this complexity in the tax system is what provides the wriggle room for these quite startling losses to UK GDP. And I suppose I'm surprised to hear both of you not really having followed up why the plan is to get rid of the Office of Tax Simplification.
If I might come in there first, yeah, and then hand over to Ben. So, on the kind of like last point there, I should add that we have a tax sector at the IFS. Colleagues there might be a little bit more on top of the issues. Unfortunately, they're on leave at this moment. In terms of, you know, what role we can play going forward, we do a lot of research on tax, including looking at tax avoidance and tax evasion, and the impact of audits on sort of tax receipts and so on. So we'll continue to do that work. The IFS also has what's called the Tax Law Review Committee, which is a sort of, it's coordinated by the IFS, but it involves tax lawyers and tax accountants, as well as an economist or two, that looks at sort of like particular areas of the tax, where the law could work better. And some of that's around implementation and sort of like ease of use and so on, and around, is it having the impact it should have? Some of that is around looking at areas to do with avoidance and evasion. So we are sort of looking at that. I think the main organization that sort of, you know, looks at sort of the overall scope of, you know, whether it's error, whether it's avoidance, whether it's evasion, fraud and so on, is HMRC. And they have their tax gap analysis, which they publish every year, which I think is a useful publication. And in fact, you know, one of my other areas of work is actually in developing countries, and we've actually been trying to get developing countries to do more of this work. So I think there is work being done in this area, but I do agree with you that, you know, the removal of the Office of Tax Simplification was a step backwards, but I don't think they were the main actor in this particular area. Their main role was around simplifying tax as opposed to, designing and certainly enforcing rules related to sort of evasion and fraud. Ben, I don't know if you had any.
Yes, just a few quick things. One, I think, is that it's right to focus on the sort of enforcement agencies and the resources available to them. And I think that areas like HMRC, the National Crime Agency, those are sorts of budgets that have been squeezed over the past decade or more. And I think that you see something similar with the Environment Agency. You can't slash their budget and expect them to be able to enforce just as well as they would previously. So I think there has to be a focus on those budgets. I think that if there were lots of money that could be very easily accessed through, you know, if tackling fraud was simple and easy, I don't doubt that the government would do it as a way of raising more funding. I think this is, you know, these are long-term challenges. And I think that the scrapping of the Office for Tax Simplification is, yeah, unfortunate. We sort of had aims that align well with our own. But I don't see this necessarily through the lens of the battle against fraud and against tax evasion. I should also say, actually, one final thing is that we've got some IFS research fellows or academics who are affiliated with the IFS who've done lots of work looking at the activities of non-domiciled individuals, for example, in the tax system, and how we could raise more money from the very richest, for instance. So we are doing lots of research in this area, but perhaps not directly on the question of money lost through fraud.
Yeah, and thanks for that. And sorry for having a sound as well, having a pop at you, David. I totally appreciate your expertise can't cover everything, and perhaps going forward it can be something we can fold into these sessions, because I suppose the point I'm making is we're talking, relatively speaking, although they feel like quite big numbers, they pale into insignificance when we look across the whole gabit. And you're correct, Ben, about what you say about cuts in HMRC, which would suggest to me that this can only get worse rather than get better. And whilst you're right that this is an issue globally, the UK is well up there in terms of the league tables of being, I think, the second most corrupt after the US, although, again, people might argue about that, which is why I think it's important, because we're tending to look at what we can see rather than and guess at what we can't, when that is growing at a rate of knots. Thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thank you. I don't get helps to have tax havens within the British Isles itself, really, if you include the Channel Islands and Isle of Man. OK, one thing, just to finish off with me, is just to say that we've talked about the GDPR inflator, but what really matters to people who are actually putting in pay claims is the public perception. And it's all about the headline rather than things like the GDPR deflator, I would suggest. So I think in how that impacts really in terms of the public sector is very significant. So we're in a situation whereby we've got the UK government might say, well, Treasury costs are this, blah, blah, blah. So that's a GDPR inflator, but that's not really how the public really see it. They just see what's on the news and what's in the papers. Ben?
So was there a response on that? Yes. This is the challenge, isn't it? If you're a public sector worker, clearly you care about the rate of inflation that you're facing, jobs and for the things that you purchase, and clearly that's probably best captured by something like CPI, which is running at in the region of 10%. That's so clearly a payoffer of 5% for you is going to represent a real terms hit to your pay and living standards. The challenge for public services generally is that all of these budgets were set when inflation wasn't expected to be so high, and it's this challenge of trying to, if you've got budgets that are predicated on paywalls of 2 or 3%, even offering 5%, it's going to feel really painful, and you have to make savings from somewhere else. But that still feels like a real terms cut, and it is a real terms cut for those workers. And on both sides have both the people trying to manage the budgets of public services and the workers. Both can legitimately feel aggrieved and like they're in a difficult situation. I think this is just the public sector pays one of the real tricky areas of policy at the moment. And I'm not saying at all that your nurses, your teachers, your train drivers shouldn't be focused on DPI or the rate of inflation they're facing. They, of course, should. Just this has to be taken in the round of overall fiscal policy.
Yeah, I mean, the point I was making is that, setting a GDPR, Treasury deflator, which clearly doesn't really take any account, that what pay demands are going to be, realistically, isn't very helpful.
Well, it's a measure of inflation used, for a long time. It's a measure of domestic inflation used for all sorts of things. In particular, if you ever hear about forecasts for real GDP versus nominal GDP, like how much more actual economic activity have we got versus just inflation? Is used for that. It enters all sorts of things. I think there's good reasons for the Treasury to use one economy-wide measure to sort of try and treat all public services equally. And in normal times, DPI and the GDP deflator track each other fairly closely. This is a sort of exceptional period. I don't think the conclusion from that should be that we should toss that measure of inflation out and just abandon it entirely. I think what is required is some flexibility and some recognition from the Treasury that actually the cost pressures on public services might be greater than is suggested by the headline figures, and particularly when you take into account the potential pay awards, I think that flexibility is what's needed rather than necessarily throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
Exactly, that's the kind of point I was trying to get at, but you've done it in a much more articulate way than I was doing. Okay, well, I want to thank our witnesses for their excellent contributions today and for answering all our questions, and also to thank colleagues around the table for their contributions. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which we'll discuss in private, is consideration of our work programme. So we now move into a private session. I call a 5-minute break until noon. Thank you very much, David. Thank you very much, Ben.